I talked a little bit earlier today about different blends of music, and sometimes I'm asked, what do you think is the most important? Is there one genre of American music, Southern music, that is the most important, the most prevalent? And absolutely, yes. I absolutely do believe that blues is the most important genre of American music simply because it's the most versatile. Blues blends with everything. It's easy to take any style of music, mix a little blues into it, and you've got a brand new style of music. And there are so many different genres of Southern music that have the blues mixed in. You do not have to be a professional musician to hear that either. That's the best part. That's the good news. A lot of times you're just sort of told, the blues is in this, just trust me. And if you can't hear it, that doesn't do you any good. So that's what I want to do today. I want to help you hear that in different kinds of music. My wife did not come with me this time. She was here 4 years ago. She is home taking care of the dogs, cats, turkeys, deer, all the wildlife we've got. But she's a writer. She's not a professional writer. She writes poetry. She writes fiction just for herself. She likes to, that's her pastime is to write. And she looks at literature a lot differently than I do. We could read the same book and then talk about it later, and I'm just bewildered that we actually read the same thing. She can ask me, what did you think about that part where the little boy fell into the creek? And my response is, well, it's hard to swim when you got wet blue jeans on. That's how I interpreted that scene. And she'll go off into symbolism of baptism and how the little boy came out of the water a changed person. He was different towards his sister. He had a cathartic change. And I think, wow, I wish I'd read that book. That's not totally different from what I read. She does the same thing with movies and television. We went to see the movie Blue Velvet when it came out, and I was disturbed by that movie. It deeply disturbed me, and we walked out, and she was just ecstatic. She enjoyed the thing totally. And I asked her what was so great about it, and she said, did you not notice all the red, white, and blue? All the way through the movie, all the scenes that featured red, white, and blue, symbolic of the American dream that was just kind of crumbling into something dismaying as you're watching. I thought, no, I wish I'd watched that movie instead. The one I watched was really, really disturbing. But music works the same way. There are different levels that you can listen to music on, and you don't have to listen deeper to enjoy music. You can listen to simply the lyrics and the beat and be totally happy your entire life. You can go decades of paying attention to nothing more than lyrics and the beat and have a totally satisfying lifetime experience of music. Most Americans will confirm that that's what they pay attention to the most in music, or lyrics and the beat. That seems to be what's most important to Americans. Around the world, it's different things. Asian people tend to listen more to instruments and harmony. They tend to pay more attention to that than lyrics and the beat. It just depends on where you are. However, there are different levels of music. You can get down deeper into music like you can literature, and it doesn't take a lot of expertise. You don't have to be a skilled musician. You don't have to be trained. You don't have to have experience. Anyone can do it. Some of the levels are difficult. Some of the levels of music require some very focused years of training, years of music theory, years of performing and writing, and it gets difficult. You have to be trained to understand certain levels of music. But thankfully, that's only a few of them. Most of them are very accessible to anybody with a pair of ears that could hear. And the easiest one to hear, I've learned, is form. Musical form is the easiest thing to pick up on if you have no experience in music. Form in music is how a song is put together. It's kind of the construction of a song. And when people write music, it doesn't just spill out of their heads randomly. They have kind of a plan in mind as to how they want the verses and refrains to kind of line up. And they get kind of a flow as they go through it. It doesn't happen randomly. And the plan of a song is simply based on the concepts of repetition and contrast. That means when you listen to music, that's what your brain is doing. Even though your brain doesn't tell you that's what it's doing, that's what it's doing. It is comparing everything you hear in a song to everything else you heard before that point. Everything you're listening to in any song at any moment is either a repetition of something you've already heard, or it's different from anything else you've heard so far, brand new. And your brain has been doing this since you were about two. It just never bothered to tell you that's what it was doing. That's the way it organizes music in your head. The form of music is by repetition and contrast. Music typically comes in phrases, just like language. And we tend to like phrases that are in even numbers. We like two phrases. We like four phrases of music. That's just natural in Western culture. The song Happy Birthday has four phrases to it. And the first phrase is Happy Birthday to you. That's the first phrase. Now, we would typically give that in sort of mapping out the form. We'd give it the letter A because that's the first letter. So the second phrase of the song is Happy Birthday to you. Well, that's the same, so we give it the same letter. Now the third phrase of the song, Happy Birthday Dear Somebody, well, that one's different, so we give it a different letter. And then it ends up, Happy Birthday to you. So there you go, you get the same letter again. So that's the form of the song, Happy Birthday. As simple as that is, A-A-B-A. And again, your brain started to figure this out when you were two. It just never bothered to tell you that it had already figured out the form of Happy Birthday. Otherwise, every time you hear it, it would sound random and chaotic to you. But it makes sense. As it turns out, most songs in Western culture have four phrases that follow that A-A-B-A form. We like that form. That's a natural form to us. And by Western culture, I mean Europe and North America over the past 1,000 years. That includes Germany, Italy, the South, everything. And we tend to like that construction of songs. So I want to show you how that works with a Frank Sinatra song. Frank Sinatra, not from the South. Unless it's South Jersey, but I think you might know this one, so I'm going to show you how this works. This is the introduction, so it doesn't count. But then you get the melody. Now remember this part. Now you should already know what to expect based on what I've said. You're going to get that same phrase again, just with different words. Now we could keep doing that phrase, but that would be boring. So we need to break it up a little bit, do something different. So you should be able to predict what's coming up next, right? Same phrase. And there you go. And that's almost the entire song is what I just played for you. And so what can you do with that? Now that you know that, what can you do with that? Can you go out and change the world? Can it give you a fatter bank account? Can you solve all your problems and fix whatever issues you have with your children, with your parents? No. All you can do is just kind of smile like I was doing that I figured out this song. I know what it's like. And it's just something that happens totally internally, and it's just kind of a cool thing. When you see people like me listening to music and we're just kind of smiling at something unknown, it could be something as simple as that. It's like, oh yeah, those two phrases match. And that's just that recognition just feels good to hang on to that. What if there were a style of music that did not have four phrases, but instead had only three phrases, and it followed this format, A-A-B. It did not have that fourth phrase. It did not return to the beginning. Instead, when it gets to the end of the form, the whole thing repeats all over again. Then you got yourself 12-bar blues. That's what 12-bar blues is. It's not the same as the typical four-phrase standard music that you hear. It is a different construction of music. It is three phrases instead of two or instead of four. Each phrase has four measures in it. So 4 + 4 + 4 is 12 measures or 12 bars. So that's why they call it 12-bar blues. But it's not just any music that has 12 measures. It needs to follow this form. The first two phrases need to match. The third phrase needs to be different. There are a lot of ways that musicians can do this, songwriters. They can do it with lyrics. That's the easiest way to do it. So let me show you what I'm talking about. This is Muddy Waters you're looking at, so just follow the lyrics. A little A is way over there. You get it again. Know what to expect, right? Something different. And then this whole thing is going to start all over again. The next one is going to be AAB again, and it'll keep that form all the way through the whole song, that AAB. It is so easy to hear with the lyrics. Again, you don't have to be a trained musician. You don't have to have any musical experience or musical talent. Anybody can hear that. You can hear that 12-bar blues in that song. Now, it's going to get confusing, but I'm going to explain it because I'm going to be saying the word blues to mean two things. I'm going to be talking about a style of music called the blues and a form of music called the blues, the AAB. And I'm going to explain that in a little bit. Let's try it again. This is Howlin' Wolf, and same thing, 12-bar blues. Easy to hear, right? And again, so far I'm talking about blues songs, a Delta blues song that happens to be in a 12-bar blues form. Those, again, those aren't going to mean the exact same thing as we go through this. I have my own theory as to where the blues comes from, where this construction comes from. Another pastime of my wife's used to be collecting quilts. Whenever we would drive, she would see a quilt hanging in someone's yard and pull in there. So we would pull in and she'd go look at it. And if they wanted to sell it to her, she'd buy it. And we got a house full of quilts. And there is a community in Alabama called G's Bend. It's a small, isolated black community, and they make handmade quilts that are stunningly gorgeous. And they make them the same way that their mamas and grandmamas and great-grandmamas made them. They just sit down as a group and just make them and talk, and they come up with these quilts, and they look like this. And what you don't see is the typical Midwestern-style quilts where all the circles are perfect and all the lines are straight and you get right angles and you get the perfect little triangles. You get this. This is what you get from a G's Bend quilt. It is not symmetrical. And I learned there is an old West African tradition that or superstition that evil travels in straight lines and evil travels in symmetrical patterns. And the way that you block evil is you do not give it straight lines or symmetrical patterns to move in. And so they make their quilts uneven so that it wouldn't be possessed. Now, they don't sit down and say, hey, let's make a quilt that's not possessed this afternoon. They just make quilts where they've always done them, but it just works out. My theory is that the 12-bar blues works the same way. It's not symmetrical. It is an asymmetrical pattern. It has two phrases and then one phrase, and then you're missing a phrase where there should be one, or you've got an extra phrase. So that's just kind of my theory as to why the 12-bar blues is constructed that way. And again, it is a style of music. There's a style of music called blues, which we've been listening to so far. But could you take that same form and apply it to different styles? Can you have a country song in 12-bar blues? Can you have a rock and roll song in 12-bar blues? Could you have an opera song in 12-bar blues? Absolutely. As long as the first two phrases match and the third one's different, that's the blues form. So you can have any genre of music you want, mix a little blues into it, and that's what ends up happening in the South is since the invention of the blues, we have added that ingredient to almost everything we've come up with. So blues is a style. Blues is also a form. I'm going to show you how to hear it. It's not as easy to hear in other forms of music as it is in the blues, but I'll show you what to listen for. Dixieland, for example, has no lyrics. You don't get a lot of songs with lyrics in Dixieland, so you kind of have to pay attention to the melody, but I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. I hope you can see these little A's. It's over there. The least you could count the 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Starts all over again. And it just keeps going all the way through. So that's a Dixieland song that's in a 12-bar blues form. Swing music very easily adapts to 12-bar blues. And it starts over. There are things melodically that are happening and harmonically that are happening in the first two phrases that are the same. Hard to hear that without lyrics. When lyrics are in there, it's a lot easier to hear. This one's a pretty fast form. Can you hear the repeat? And then different. And again, you'll see idiots like me just kind of sitting around listening to that, and we're just grinning like crazy. Like, what is that? What is he grinning at? That? I mean, it's just something as simple as that. Is this, oh yeah, that's 12-bar blues. That's cool how he did that. Little Richard makes it easy with lyrics. Here it's different. It's the same. This one's different. And it'll start all over again. And again, here's a completely different style of music, but the form of the music is still that 12-bar blues. Blues works so well. Now it's going to get a little bit more difficult because there is a part of music that you, in order to hear it, you have to have a lot of experience with this. Am I getting too far away? I saw one of these, so I'm getting too far away. Harmony and melody in music are something that you need a little experience in. So I'm not going to take you to school to try to teach you. I am going to teach you about three chords. Most songs in Western culture feature two chords that go back and forth from each other. One chord we call the one chord. It's the most important chord. The other one is its lover, the five chord, and they are attracted to each other. And whenever you get the one chord, you're going to hear the five chord, and the five chord is going to go straight back to the one chord. Most songs in Western culture simply go back and forth between these two chords over and over. Blues introduces a new chord to the mix, a third chord called the four chord. So let me show you how that works. Here's the four chord, back to the one, five, and one. And it keeps doing that. It'll go back and forth between the four chord and the one chord. Carl asked me this morning, is there something that happened to you that helped you understand? That four chord going to the one chord is called a weak cadence. Inferior music has a weak cadence to it. So blues music is inferior because it has a weak cadence. I did not hear anything inferior in blues music when I was learning to play guitar. I thought it sounded perfectly fine. So that 4-to-1 cadence that you get in blues ends up showing up in other styles of music. So the lyrics may not be there to show you, but those chord changes are there. This one's pretty easy to figure out. One chord. Four chord. One chord. And then five. Back to one. Now, have you noticed that those previous two songs were the same? The one chord was the first phrase. The second phrase was 4-to-1. Third phrase, 5-to-1. And that's a blues relationship that's going to keep coming out in other styles of music. Lyrics did not match in that one, but that song is still 12-bar blues. This one, the same thing. One. Four. One. Five. One. You could not pick out the 12-bar blues if you were focusing on the lyrics, but you could if you were focusing on the chords, because it's the right chords. Or just counting the measures, 12 bars. This one's really easy to do. It's not just that rockabilly music benefits from having the blues. Rockabilly music wouldn't be there if it weren't for the blues. That's what gives it that feel. That's what gives it that form, or the blues that are thrown into it. And Don, I apologize ahead of time. Yes, that's cultural appropriation. This is a long, drawn-out 12-bar blues. I'd have time to run for a beverage while this one plays. That's all the first phrase. All of the verses of that song are in a long, stretched out 12-bar blues form. I got to go back to the classroom again. Here's something difficult. Melody. The use of melody to come up with a blues form is a lot harder to hear without experience, but I'm going to try to tell you a little bit about it anyway. In Western culture, we like major scales, the Do, Re, Mi scale. If you like Sound of Music, you know the Do, Re, Mi scale. It's a seven-note scale. The first note repeats so that you get the same note at the beginning and the end of the scale. Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Ti, Do, and you start all over again. You can take some of those notes of that scale and flatten them a little bit, and you get what's called blue notes. And if you take the third note of a major scale and flatten it, that's a blue note. You take the fifth note, flatten it. The seventh note, flatten it. All of those are considered to be blue notes. So any song in a major scale, if you throw in a flatted third, a flatted fifth, a flatted seventh, then you've got yourself kind of a blues construction. So that's another way that the blues manages to work its way into other genres of music. I found this by accident. John Lennon did not do many solo concerts after the Beatles breakup. He did one in Madison Square Garden where Frank Zappa was his backup band, which is weird, but they had not rehearsed. They had no clue what they were going to play. And so in this little short audio clip, Zappa is trying to explain to the band what they're about to play. And he mentions blues changes.
Hey, sit down and cool it for a minute so you can hear what we're going to do. And for those of you in the band who have no idea what's about to happen, this is just A minor, and it's not standard blues changes.
So what he's explaining is this is not going to be the 1-4-1-5-1 that I just told you. It's going to be different chord changes. It's not going to be standard blues changes. So musicians know what that is when they talk about standard blues changes. And it's those 1-4-5 chords. I can see I'm putting you to sleep, so I'm going to try to speed up a little bit, because as soon as I get into that, oh, there he goes, the music stuff. But I do want you to hear those. That is the one chord. There's the four. Back to one. In a song we've already heard. This is what makes it blues. That four chord goes back to the one. That's a weak cadence in music. Music purists don't like that. I do. Then four. Then one. There's not a strong cadence anywhere in that song. You can take that harmonic structure and then apply that to, again, other styles of music. And bluegrass has the blues in it. It does not have 12 bar phrases. It instead has that harmonic structure I just showed you, where you get the 4-1-4-1. You get that a lot in bluegrass. This is Doc Watson. Here we go. And you get at the very end, you get a little 5-1, but everything else is 4-1-4-1-4-1. That's all blues. Maybelle Carter was taught guitar by an old blues guy, and it comes out in the Appalachian music. Oh, sorry. I didn't mean to do that. Tejano music has a lot of blues in it. Tejano music has some German music in it, too. I've been really fascinated learning a lot about Tejano music. It is strictly Texas music. It is not from anywhere else but Texas. Tejano music does not come from Mexico. It does not come from California. It comes strictly from Texas. And there were waves of German immigration throughout the 19th century, especially around failed revolutions, which would make people have to pack up and come in this direction. Not all of them settled in the Americas. Some of them settled in Mexico. And there was a large German population in Mexico for a long time until the revolutions of the turn of the 20th century forced them up into Texas. So Mexican mariachi music features the accordion, which is a German instrument. That's why mariachi music has the accordion in it. But that accordion was brought up into Texas, and you get that mixed in with the blues, which is what we'll be talking about. That's Tejano. Tejano is mariachi music with the blues thrown into it, and it sounds very different. Has the same instruments, but it sounds different from mariachi music. And you get the same accordion situation in Cajun music. You get accordion music from Germans who came up and mixed in with the French Acadians that were in Louisiana and added the accordion to their folk music. But when you throw in the blues, then you got Cajun music. And now you know how to go forth into the world and try to find 12-bar blues and music that you listen to. So, again, thank you for letting me talk to you. I've always enjoyed talking to everybody at Abbeville, and my wife is glad for me to be out of the house talking to someone else other than talking her ear off all the time. So, thank you very much.